So, okay, we're now going to switch gears. Brooks, we are going to hear about something that you all heard about but may not know how it works. We're going to hopefully find out a little bit.
IBM, talking about deep learning, machine learning. This is the granddaddy of them all.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Smith. Thank you all for having me in today. My name is Brooks Barhydt. I'm an IBM client executive. I've had the opportunity to work with MedStar over the past year. Just a quick disclaimer before I dive into the presentation. So Pete Solano called me last week, asked if I could come in and talk a little bit about Watson Health. So you've got me, the generalist. We've got our crack team of IBM Watson executives with our healthcare folks right now in Armonk. Planning out the year, but what I'm hoping to do over the next 15 to 20 minutes is give you an overview of what Watson Health is, a little bit about how it works, happy to answer some questions, and then what I'd really like to do is, depending on the interest, and I hope there's a lot, happy to follow up with any of those folks as well. So we're building out the Watson Health team significantly, as you'll see a little bit in the presentation, and we're always happy to come into MedStar and have these conversations as well. So with that, So I'll give you a Watson Health overview, and I thought for this audience what might be interesting as well is where we've gone with some of our commercial partnerships. And this is with not only providers, but publicly traded and private companies, and how we're building out what's known as the Watson Health ecosystem. So to kick it off, this is our CEO, Jenny Rometty, and she calls healthcare right now our moonshot. This is where we're putting a significant amount of our funds as we're developing the Watson Health capabilities. Now, you may or may not know, but many moons ago, IBM invented the EMR, or was a significant part of it. We moved away from that business, admittedly, probably a little early, but right now we are working tirelessly with not only Epic and Cerner and other EMR providers to build our ecosystem of data, but with other companies as well. So what is Watson, and what is IBM Watson Health? So what we're doing right now is Watson is machine learning, as Dr. Smith mentioned. It's a cognitive, it's a cognitive application. We're pulling in data from many different sources, whether it's medical literature, guidelines, institutional knowledge, across the board. So Watson ingests this data. But what you'll see in a little bit, this data doesn't really mean anything unless it's curated, unless we have the experts who go through and help us prioritize the data, turning it into something meaningful, turning it into knowledge. And so that's what we've been doing over the past few years. Many of you probably saw Watson in its infancy on Jeopardy, when it was used simply as a game show, I don't want to say gimmick, but sort of a little more high-level marketing piece, which we are also very good at the marketing. Now it's going into that practical application, and we're bringing it into different healthcare systems, and it's having a significant impact. So the pieces that we have in place right now, we have the Watson Health Cloud. This is a HIPAA-compliant and enabled cloud to maximize the sharing of information from providers all across the globe. And I'll talk a little bit about one of the first instances where we enabled Watson Health and some of its building blocks in just a little bit. We've made more than 30 acquisitions and continue to partner with companies. It's that data that we continue to ingest. That's really where the value add is here. You may have read about some of our acquisitions and seen things like we acquired the weather company. It's digital assets, actually. It's driving insights out of different areas that you may not normally think of and applying them to those outcomes, whether it be with patients or in other industries as well, be it retail, media, and entertainment, and being able to correlate those. So Watson is the underpinning of that, being able to bring together these large amounts of data with that curation to generate those insights. And then we've built out ecosystem solutions as well. And that can come from acquisitions as well. We acquired Exploris and Phytel in this space, Merge to help us look at images in the medical space as well. Ustream was a recent acquisition. Now, this is interesting. It got a lot of publicity because of the media and entertainment impact. But what it does is it helps us move live video files from different areas. And you're starting to see some of that play into telemedicine and things of that nature as well. And then our partnerships. So our most notable partnerships are probably with Memorial Sloan Kettering, which we partnered on an oncology solution. MD Anderson was also part of our oncology ecosystem. We're working with Mayo right now on clinical trial matching, and we also have a strong partnership with Cleveland Clinic. That being said, and just something to think about, our next two areas that we're looking at right now, and we announced yesterday a partnership with the American Heart Association, are cardiology and diabetes. But we're continuing to explore partnerships as we build out what this ecosystem is going to look like in the future. So this is the Watson Health Cloud, and these are the different pieces that are being pulled into it. So it's looking at an end-to-end solution here. And when you think of the care process as rather linear, you can engage the Watson Health Cloud in any of these pieces, whether it's through, you know, the real-world evidence, you've got your pop health management, and it takes it from that first care experience, whether it's scheduling your appointment to come in, whether it's the care that you're receiving from the provider, and all the way to the end where hopefully the care experience was a positive one and you had a good outcome, and perhaps your family or yourself becomes a donor of the institution as well. It's finding that cross-section more quickly between capacity and the inclination as well from a donor perspective. And that's where Watson is helping to provide those insights as well. So we continue to add partners and acquisitions which build upon our capabilities. What you see right now as part of the Watson Health ecosystem, we're pulling in social and unstructured text. That's the big difference with IBM Watson, is that unstructured text. As I'm sure all of you know, the typical structured text, rows and columns, that makes up about 20% of known data right now. It's the unstructured text, which is the other 80%, whether it's audio files, video files, natural language processing. All of those components have been put into Watson so we can drive insights out of areas that haven't been evaluated before. I mentioned the weather before, and it's also enabling this these insights to be pushed out on different platforms. So mobility in a healthcare setting. We work closely with Apple, enabling those partnerships, developing those applications. One thing that we've done with a number of providers is if there is an interest in building a specific application with Apple, we will partner with them for a planning session, and then we will all go out to Cupertino and into the Apple labs. We're the only other company aside from Apple that has access to those labs, and it's a really interesting opportunity to build these applications that are engineered by IBM but designed by Apple. It's probably one of the most powerful partnerships you'll see out there. You probably don't want us to do some of that front design, though that's changing because we acquired a lot of these interactive agencies. We acquired one just the other day, so we're going to put a nice polish on a lot of this. Images I mentioned through the acquisition of Merge Video, and the list goes on. And some of the partners in the ecosystem we have here are Facebook and Twitter, Apple I mentioned. We work closely with CVS. Out at CES, which is the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas, our CEO, Ginni Rometty, was out there, and we announced partnerships with Under Armour and Medtronic as well. So we were taking that personalized insight on the outputs that you're getting from, it wouldn't be Fitbit, but the different areas of input that you're getting from exercise and wellness, and bringing that together as part of that data ecosystem that I mentioned as well. And I mentioned some of our acquisitions before. So some of the differentiation here, and I want to just go over this briefly, but not only is IBM a leader in security, mobility, and the cloud, but the Bluemix platform, and I want to talk about this. I don't know if there are any developers in the room right now, and you don't need to be. I've played around on Bluemix. I'm certainly not a developer, but Bluemix basically gives you the building blocks that you can create your own applications, and the reason I bring this up and what's sort of interesting about this is we're working with another provider locally who's using Bluemix as a revenue stream for them as well. So they define what may be needed as part of an application in a healthcare setting, and they go in and they use that natural language processing that I mentioned, all of these different APIs that you can plug into and play around with to meet your needs. When you create that specific application for your needs, something that's unique in the marketplace, you can put that out there on the IBM Bluemix marketplace and sell it as well. So it's an opportunity to generate some revenue. That's where we're seeing some of these best-in-class solutions out there. One of the first that was developed, and this was actually in conjunction with Bluemix and Apple, was actually for the airline industry, where pilots would come back and they'd be able to, without deplaning, they could signal as soon as they were rolling into the gate with the flight attendants as well, change in reservations for the folks who were on the plane, how much fuel was needed, and communicate that more efficiently so they were reducing delays and they were increasing satisfaction as well. So those are some of the tools that you can enable. That's outside of a healthcare example, but just some of the things that you can do leveraging these tools as well. We also have IBM Research Collaboration. A number of our folks who work up in Yorktown Heights have been a part of this project since the beginning as well. And we come in as a non-aligned partner. As I mentioned, from an EMR perspective, we've worked closely with Cerner and Epic before and a number of other providers to draw out that clinical information out of their systems and be able to extract that and manipulate it in a number of different ways for their insight. Here are the actual solutions that are available right now, and I'll just talk about these very briefly. This one's for life sciences. I mentioned Watson for oncology, so I'll just take a minute to focus on that because that was our very first partnership with Memorial Sloan Kettering. So we had designed and built Watson, had already been on Jeopardy. And after that had gone out on air, the first calls we were receiving were from the healthcare industry, and Memorial Sloan Kettering was one of the first folks who talked to Jenny. And what they were looking to do was, how could we apply that machine learning and those insights into oncology? So we spent about 8 months digesting all of the medical literature that we could. And where the partnership comes into place is MSK, with their experts, came in and they curated that data. They prioritized what was important and how they should be able to drive that from not only the clinical data, but that medical literature as well. And so they come in and we'd start seeing patients. The purpose of it wasn't necessarily for MSK directly. Obviously, they had the expertise. They were able to give appropriate diagnoses. But it was bringing the knowledge of Memorial Sloan Kettering around the world as well. And so one of the first places Watson for Oncology was used was over in Thailand, where maybe the training wasn't quite the same, the expertise wasn't the same that was available. And so you're able to input the different symptoms, the different information about the patients, and help the clinicians drive towards an appropriate diagnosis quicker, faster, more rapidly. But again, it takes the curation of those experts to make this work well. Watson for clinical trial matching, that's going on at Mayo right now. It's again matching, it's just as it sounds, matching folks who are looking for clinical trials more quickly based on the inputs from Mayo and centralized clinical trials that are available. It's speeding it up more rapidly, driving revenue to Mayo and helping the patients more quickly. And Curum is more for a social services solution from governments and things like that, matching people with services more rapidly. So I'll just briefly touch on the commercial partnership, and then I want to make sure I leave time for some questions here. So the commercial partnership, and this is a little bit about what we've done with some of the other major providers, we work together on a governance structure and management with dedicated project teams that would be here at MedStar. Executive sponsorship from the IBM side as well. Access to all of our products from Watson Health data and capabilities and those end-to-end solutions. So it's really working on finding that first access to new products, data, and capabilities, and making that differentiation at the provider. And this is just a difference between a traditional vendor relationship and a commercial partnership as well. But as you imagine, there's significantly more that goes into the commercial partnership. And again, happy to chat about that a little bit further as there's interest. So we're bringing in the research, the health system, the collaborations, merging it with that commercialization of those products that are identified. I've touched on oncology, I've touched on clinical trial matching, and again, we're looking towards cardiology now and diabetes, and we continue to drive that through our cognitive enterprise. So it really is an opportunity to bring innovation together from the organization, whether it be MI2 or driving from IBM as well. It's a great partnership model. And ultimately, these are the two areas that are going to drive this forward, is the data coming out of MedStar and the clinical role and expertise. All of you are the experts. MedStar is the experts. MedStar knows MedStar better than anything else. What we bring to the table is that platform, is that cognition, the ability to ingest the clinical data and make it connect with the appropriate use cases here at MedStar. And we've continued to do that through the partnerships, as I mentioned, and driving real-world evidence as well. We also like to release a global press announcement every time we put these great partnerships together. These are just a couple of them. Over in the Nordics, Novo Nordisk teamed up with IBM Watson Health to create a virtual doctor. That was our first foray into diabetes. We're looking to grow that, especially in the States. And then CVS and IBM have partnered. I know CVS is a significant partner of MedStar as well, but we continue to do that to make sure that we're looking for that population health end-to-end engagement with patients when they leave MedStar, when they're getting their treatment, and making sure we continue that correlation as well. This is a summary of what that partnership framework looks like. Everything from the private companies to acquisitions, and then what IBM brings to the table as well, from our architects to our project managers, and being able to help monetize these solutions as well. Thank you. I know that was a quick overview, high level of Watson Health, but happy to answer any questions. And again, as I mentioned, if you want to go specifically down a detailed avenue, I'm happy to connect you with our experts as well. So any questions I can answer? Yeah.
So you talked about your project with Sloan Kettering.
Yeah. Sure.
Do you have any ideas to how big of an effort that is to maybe in the context of that project with MSK?
Sure. So that's a great question. How long it took us to curate the data. And again, what's interesting about Watson is because it's a learning machine, it gets faster each time it does this and ingests it. So when it was reading the medical data and the medical journals, a lot of that was done by IBM researchers, being able to load that in. But when we're bringing the clinical data in as well, it was about an 8 to 12 month ramp up time. It depends on what the project is that we look at right now. Obviously, you have that underpinning of data as well, but it is a significant effort to bring that together. But it's now under that year mark, typically. That's a great question. Yeah. Yes.
Mm-hmm. In medicine, I'm just wondering whether you can comment on the vision side of Watson.
Sure. Yeah, that comes again from the merge acquisition. The vision right now, so it's that component of it remains in flight because it's still a static loading of the images in there. It's not real time. The output isn't happening like that at the moment. But right now, it can ingest that knowledge, but it can't read film at the moment. That's where we're working on taking it at the. And that's where Merge sort of vaulted us forward as well. So it doesn't truly read it yet, but that is the direction of the technology.
So are there products in the Watson suite that actually read the entire text of a publication, not just the abstracts, to do data mining? I mean, so basically, is information from the methods in the results section,
yep,
are mined and available as a product, mm-hmm, kept up to date from, say, PubMed, for example, for all the medical articles?
Sure. It reads the text, and it can read handwriting as well, which is neat.
And it structures it that we can then mine.
Correct. Yep. That's where it's pulling out. It's reading the text. It's pulling the notes out. And, if Watson can handle doctor's handwriting, it can do a lot. So it continues to pull that out, and that's where you're getting that unstructured bit that can then be put into an easily digestible and identified format
so
as well.
You can feed it PubMed articles and it'll structure it for you.
Yeah, that's what it does. Mm-hmm.
Can I structure Watson to look at some more inexact kinds of medical issues such as autism or mental diseases where everybody's got an opinion but nobody really has an answer, where perhaps the aggregate from a large brain machine learning system, mm-hmm, will give us insight on something we don't know?
We're exploring all use cases right now. I can't, tell you if where we are with autism specifically, but the process in which we do is defining the use case together and then building those parameters around it. So the challenging thing about something where there's not a conclusive outcome, and a lot of these still, there isn't one necessarily. What Watson does, for instance, in a diagnosis, is it gives you a range of probabilities. And so you could...
My
Exactly. So you could apply it in that sort of way as well. So, for instance, one of the first times Watson was used was there was a young child who came in to the hospital. They, you know, we couldn't figure out what was wrong with them. It was taking the doctors quite a bit of time. And Watson's highest probability that came back that hadn't at all been considered was, and I don't know what this is personally, it was Kawasaki disease. And so it's where Watson is highlighting these probabilities where maybe it wouldn't be the first place to look. So for autism, absolutely, we could figure out what the definition would be and what it would look like as well.
Is it able then to track over time and feedback? So if it's giving you a set of differential diagnoses and the probability of them, but you track that patient and you find out what the actual course was, mm-hmm. feeding that back in kind of a Bayesian way to update the probabilities.
That's exactly, and that's where that curation comes yeah. too. And because Watson hasn't been in the marketplace for all that long, we're still in the early stages of what has been, you know, proven out, what was the accuracy of that and continuing to update it. But that's its learning mechanism is, and as the symptoms change, perhaps the probabilities change as well. So we certainly do that. Sure, and a lot of Watson specifically. I mean, the platform isn't necessarily the challenge behind it. It's just what is going to be available there. We work closely with Apple, as I mentioned, and we work with all the providers as well. But different suites of if it's predictive analytics are available on different formats as well. But from Watson specifically, I know there are teams working on that. Yeah.
My understanding of Watson from the beginning was that it was basically one of these neural net type machine learning systems. Mm-hmm. I, from what you're describing, it seems like it's different from that now. Is that correct?
As for the specifics, I don't want to go too far or I would say the wrong thing here. The part of Watson where it started, it continues to evolve. I mean, the person who invented Watson has since left the company, but it continues to grow and change as the application changes. And Watson Health is even separate from a lot of the other ways in which we leverage the Watson technology. Yeah, Jeff.
Can you highlight the Under Armour relationship? I'm just curious why an apparel company is working with you guys.
Sure. Now, that's a great question. That's sort of a neat story. And so what Under Armour is doing right now, you're starting to ingest that data from the sensors that they put out, and what we're going to create with them is something called the personalized coach. So we know your blood pressure when you exert yourself in a certain way. We know, it goes beyond just the calories that you're burning, but really what is truly working for your body and what isn't, and recommended courses of action for how you can train in the future as well. And so that app, the way you can apply that goes in so many different ways, but what Under Armour is doing is they don't see themselves actually as an apparel company. They would tell you they're a data company, and that's what their differentiation is going to be. And so what we're doing is giving them a sense of, okay, you have that data, we can read it from the products that they have out to their consumers, and then help them design a coaching program, because not only does Under Armour, provide that apparel, but they own MapMyFitness, they own a number of these different entities, and we can help aggregate, you're going for your 5-mile run, and not only the inputs that you have to make, but we can help read them out as well and give you a customized plan. And I think you've probably seen a lot lately, the business of fitness is just booming lately, and being able to capitalize on that and work with them to create a more holistic interaction with their consumers outside of great products that they put out as well. Okay.
Thank you, Russ.
Thank you very much for having me in.